extra this morning. I gave you extra time. Scripture time. I tried to give you as much time as possible. No, I know. We need more fellowship, don't we? We'll start with Genesis 46 this morning. We'll read the first 7 verses. Thank you, Lord. Happy 2020. Israel traveled with all that he had and came to Bethsheba and offered sacrifices to the God of his father, Isaac. God spoke to Israel in the visions of the night and said, "Jacob, Jacob." He said, "Here I am." He said, "I am God, the God of your father. Don't be afraid to go down into Egypt, for there I will make of you a great nation. I will go down with you into Egypt. I will also surely bring you up again. Joseph will close your eyes." Jacob rose up from Beersheba, and the sons of Israel carried Jacob, their father, their little ones, and their wives in the wagons which Pharaoh had sent to carry him. They took their livestock and their goods, which they had gotten in the land of Canaan, and came into Egypt, Jacob and all his seed with him, his sons and his sons' sons with him, his daughters and his sons' daughters, and he brought all his seed with him into Egypt. And the second reading will be from Psalm 77. And we'll read the second half of the Psalm 11 through 20. A psalm by Asaph. I will remember Yah's deeds, for I will remember your wonders of old. I will also meditate on all your work and consider your doings. Your way, God, is in the sanctuary. What God is great like God? You are the God who does wonders. You have made your strength known among the peoples. You have redeemed your people with your arm, the sons of Jacob and Joseph. The waters saw you, God. The waters saw you, and they writhed. The depths also convulsed. The clouds poured out water. The skies resounded with thunder. Your arrows also flashed around. The voice of your thunder was in the whirlwind. The lightnings lit up the world. The earth trembled and shook. Your way was through the sea, your paths through the great waters. Your footsteps were not known. You led your people like a flock by the hand of Moses and Aaron. Thank you, Lord. And from the New Testament, 1 Peter we'll read from chapter 4. And we'll read the second half of that chapter, 12 through 19. An important reminder for today. I think about this verse a lot. Beloved, don't be astonished at the fiery trial which has come upon you to test you, as though a strange thing happened to you. But because you are partakers of Christ's sufferings, rejoice, that at the revelation of his glory, you also may rejoice with exceeding joy. If you are insulted for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you. On their part, he is blasphemed, but on your part, he is glorified. For let none of you suffer as a murderer or a thief, or an evildoer, or a meddler in other men's matters. But if one of you suffers for being a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in this matter. For the time has come for judgment to begin with the household of God. If it begins first with us, what will happen to those who don't obey the good news of God? If it is hard for the righteous to be saved, what will happen to the ungodly and the sinner? Therefore, let them also who suffer according to the will of God in doing good entrust their souls to him as to a faithful creator. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Master. And our final reading will be from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 2. And again, we'll read the second half, beginning with verse 13. Now, when they had departed, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream, saying, "Arise and take the young child and his mother and flee into Egypt and stay there until I tell you, for Herod will seek the young child to destroy him." He arose and took the young child and his mother by night and departed into Egypt and was there until the death of Herod, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, saying, "Out of Egypt I called my son." Then Herod, when he saw that he was mocked by the wise men, was exceedingly angry and sent out and killed all the male children who were in Bethlehem and in all the surrounding countryside, from 2 years old and under, according to the exact time which he had learned from the wise men. Then that which was spoken by Jeremiah the prophet was fulfilled, saying, "A voice was heard in Ramah, lamentation, weeping, and great mourning, Rachel weeping for her children, for she wouldn't be comforted because they are no more." But when Herod was dead, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt, saying, "Arise and take the young child and his mother, and go into the land of Israel, for those who sought the young child's life are dead." He arose and took the young child and his mother and came into the land of Israel. But when he heard that Archelaus was reigning over Judea in the place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there. Being warned in a dream, he withdrew into the region of Galilee and came and lived in a city called Nazareth, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken through the prophets, "He will be called a Nazarene." Amen.
How many like the old hymns? This is an old hymn we're starting with today, but it's a good one. Anybody want to hip us with the overhead? You got to be ready to preach, pray, sing, die at a moment's notice in this place, right? Always got to be ready. The Lord might draft you. Anybody get a prayer answered beginning of the year?
Joseph and Solomon, and God's just taking care of me one step at a time in a magnificent way.
Amen. Hallelujah. That's good. Anybody else? Andy, don't forget to get that little, do you see that little?
Yeah. Yes.
I had a smidgen, the rest went too.
The lady I live with, she inhaled it That was good stuff. How many like baklava?
Oh, yeah.
Andy's the handyman you want because he comes bearing gifts. You pay him and he gives you baklava, so. He did a great job. He always does, too. There's a miracle. Happy New Year miracle. Are you driving now? You're driving now?
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh. The mind boggles. Wow. He had a procedure, Bill. Different ones have had different procedures, and we're here, right? It's awesome. God is great. I told Pat I survived a little dental thing. That's kid stuff compared to the other things, but I'm still glad. Better than the alternative. Oh, man, I didn't wind up with Bell's palsy like Barb. Remember when she came in with a droopy face? She's not feeling so good today. I hear Kathy's not well, and a lot of people still struggling with stuff. But God's faithful, amen? Let's stand together, give him praise today. He's got good news for us, always does. I expect to hear from heaven today. I expect gifts of the Spirit, don't you?
Amen.
So many of us praying through the week and looking to God for wonderful services, and he hears and catalogs those requests, and then he sends the answers down. Praise the Lord.
Praise you, Lord.
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 Praise the Lord.
Praise you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Let's go back to the songbook today. Amen. Beautiful hymn.
What it says.
Wow.
Why don't you just play?
Let's do it again. We'll get it. We'll get it. We'll get it. If it worked, it worked. Try it again.
Would you be free from the burden of sin? There's power in the blood. Power in the blood. Would you be
say. Hallelujah. I guess Ron's singing this around the throne now. He's got a different vantage point.
Yeah.
We're still here, and he's got the front row seat now. He's been looking for it for a long time. He was a Christian for decades, so he's had his eye on heaven for a long time. That's a great testimony, isn't it? Walk with God for decades. Some people feel like it's the end of the world, you know, if they can't walk with God for 10 minutes, but how about several decades? That's the real deal. Amen. We celebrated, I can't get over, it's been 2 years already, celebrated the 500th anniversary of the Protestant Reformation 2 years ago, October 31st, and this is where really what it was all about, rediscovery of grace, rediscovery of mercy, rediscovery of God's gift and not our work.
Thank you.
It makes all the difference, doesn't it? Beautiful song. If you don't know, I try to mention it when I think about it. We don't do that song a whole lot. But it was written by a brother who's a Messianic Jewish believer many, many years ago. And you know, he was, I think, one of the first Christian evangelists to be allowed to minister the gospel in Mauritania. It's a country in Africa. And when I was in Australia many years ago, I was having a prayer time before a meeting I had in a city called Bundaberg. Beautiful pastor there named Ray Hanna. He had gone to India every year as a missionary evangelist from his own church, and got me a lot of meetings all over the north of Australia just on his word because of our meetings there. And while I was there, I remember it like it happened yesterday. I was praying in my bedroom before we went to the meeting, and the Lord spoke to me that I would someday go and preach in Mauritania. I didn't even know where it was. Finally looked on the map, saw it was in Africa, knew nothing about it. Heavily Islamic country. and it's just absolutely dead to the gospel. Years later, I found out that this brother had actually gone there and had a wonderful crusade. So maybe he did my work for me. What do you think? I don't know. But it just goes to show you, man says no, circumstances no, God says yes, and off you go. And he lived close to God. I believe he's still alive. Scott's first name. Can't remember his last name. Jeff might know. Scott something or other. But anyway, a beautiful song he wrote. So pray for Martini if you think about it. I don't know whether they're still closed like that to the gospel, but they were back in the day when I first heard about that country. This again reminds me of Brother Ron, who's experiencing what we're singing about. I just kind of almost feel his presence, you know, leaning over the banister. Sing it, sing it. We're doing it here. Sing it. God bless Ron. Had his promotion at 81 years old. Decades and decades as a believer. God bless him. God bless his memory, his life, his legacy. Let's keep a smile like he did through all that he was through. Thank you. thanks, Lord, for how you rise from your rest to smite the enemy in the hinder parts. When he comes in one way, he flees seven. We thank you how you rise from your rest to meet your children as they come home, as you stood to embrace your first martyr, Stephen, as he prayed in his dying breaths, "Lay not this sin to their charge." Lord, we bring before you anyone and everyone who has done anything or everything contrary to us, unto or toward us, Lord. Lay not their sins to their charge. We release them, Lord, from any and all responsibility or debt toward us. We pray for them that you grant them the gift of a change of mind about their relationship with you and their relationship toward us. Thank you for the cross of Christ that forgives the abused and the abuser both. Thank you for taking the place of the abused one and the abuser in the cross, healing the one, forgiving the other. Thank you, Lord, for being the Son of Man.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
One made like us.
Glory be to God. Just close your eyes this morning and think about Jesus. You're welcome to release the prayer language of the Holy Spirit as we play through this song. Sing unto the Lord a new song.
Bye.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I am enthroned upon your praise this morning, says the Lord. And every song you sing and every prayer you pray and every praise you offer is recorded in my book. Your prayers are received at the altar of grace and mercy and mixed with fire from the altar by the angels of my presence. They are sent back, and the prayers cause lightnings and thunderings in the earth, says the Lord. And the hearts of many are laid bare. And I diagnose and I determine that which each person needs. And then I call forth my servants, one skilled in this way, another in that, and send them to the place of the one sighing and dying and crying, bruised and beaten and battered on the Jericho roads of life. And my children kneel down in the dirty, dusty place and pour in the oil and the wine and bind up the one that has been bruised. They bandage that one and bring him to the healing center, which is each and every assembly that I have birthed by my spirit in any town or city or village or country or nation on earth. And there they are restored week by week, service by service, as each one ministers to the other, iron sharpening iron, building up one another in the faith once for all delivered to the saints. And I have left behind more than enough silver in the gifts and operations and manifestations of my spirit. And I have made possible more than enough currency of this world to supply the needs of my children who are in the healing centers regularly, being ministered to by my word and by my spirit, and finding their lives changing day by day by day, moving more and more and more into a perfect image of the one in whose image they have been created and made, says the Lord. And when the last one has been restored, and the last prodigal has returned home, and the last sheep has heard my voice and followed me to the healing center, the trumpet will sound, the shout will be heard, the dead in Christ will rise first, and the ones alive and remaining shall be caught up to meet the returning, conquering sovereign in the air. And so shall my people always be one with me, says the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you for that, Lord. Thank you for that. Glory be to Jesus.
For my people are an unusual people, says the Lord. They are the ones who invite my presence into their life. They are the ones that rejoice when they can feel me working in their lives. They are not like the usual ones of this earth that shun me and scorn me and turn away from me. And even if they believe in me or say they do, they don't want my interference with their life and their plans. They don't want me. They only want what I can give them when they're in trouble, says the Lord. But you are not like that. You are an unusual people, and I love you, and you love me with an unusual love. And there is no love like this. There is no love that will last forever like this love. You are an unusual people, says the Lord, and don't try to be usual. Don't try to go out of your way to please the usual ones, says the Lord, for I have made you unusual, and you cannot turn around and become usual like them. You will always be my unusual people, says the Lord, and how I love you, says the Lord. And how I long to be with you as you long to be with me. And how unusual is that?
while we're in God's presence, it's like watching a movie, like watching a video. I can hear these marching footsteps, and I can see these soldiers coming, coming, coming. And every soldier is in step. Every footstep is in step. Praise God. And I hear the Lord saying, this is the end time army of God. And it's not one church, it's not one denomination, it's not one faith group or parachurch ministry. It's individual believers of every stripe, but they're one, even though their labels might be different. And they're not the entire congregation of every denomination or faith group or local church or parachurch ministry. They're the remnant in each of those outwardly visible organizations. They're only a small remnant. But when the small remnant from each and every group comes together, it's like a mighty multitude. And the sound is so loud, you almost can't, it's deafening. Just circling the globe with the good news gospel of grace and peace and glory. And they're fully armed with the full armor of God, with the nature of God, the fruit of the Spirit, and with the power of God, the gifts of the Spirit. And they're doing what no man can do to change things in every quarter on planet Earth. It's the last great move of God, the last era in this era of grace. And it's going to be something. We thank you, Lord. You've got a unity that we can't produce. You've got a fellowship that we can't create or legislate. You've got a church that we can't brand or put together. And Lord, we just let go of the natural. We aim to keep our eyes on the supernatural, the spiritual, the eternal. Thanks for your church, Lord, within the visible church. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Have a seat. Here, that's the main thing. If you don't yet know, please pray for Ron's family. He made the transition this morning, not too long before service. And he is on the other side with the saints of the Lord. Latest and last final battle was with cancer, of all things, after facing so many other challenges. And that was the final challenge. And he was ready to go. He told Solomon and me several times he was ready to go. So I think he finished his course. Please take this with you. It has all the information there that you need. It's a shame. One little digit on Bobby Mounce's address, the zip code, one digit was incorrect as it was given to us. Anyway, but it's 45251, not 41 as it reads in the directory. So we have the new address, street address, but there was one mistake there on the zip code. So make that in your directory if you don't mind. We'll be here Wednesday. I might be sharing just a little bit beside the teaching about something the Lord showed me about these end time days we're living in and how the ministry's going to work. Be very encouraging to you, I think. Who's got the January birthday?
Me.
Okay. You know what? I don't think it's a... Someone's excited about birthday. Yeah, that's true. There'll be coffee out there, too. Lord willing, a creek don't rise. I think it's there. Let's cut it down the middle, I guess. I think Solomon, he got the cake this time instead of me. Different place. Did a really nice job. But as I looked at it, see if you think, it looks to me like maybe it's a half sheet rather than a quarter. Is it? And wow, what a discount.
because the Kroger one for a quarter sheet is like 18 bills, right? This was 20, and it looks like a half. He just got it because he was at Sam's. I thought, well, bye-bye Kroger and hello Sam's. Esther used to get them. Esther used to get them at Sam's when she was doing it, and then turned it over to whoever wanted to do it, and it usually is me. And I just went to Kroger. We've tried several places, but maybe more bang for our buck, but please take some with you. There's way too much. If you seal that baby right, it's still moist on Wednesday, so we can have the residue on Wednesday. You put that top on. I've tested this, because Monday morning, Tuesday morning, bring coffee to the church, and there's a dessert. But if you keep that on, it'll still be moist Wednesday, so if you're here for Wednesday night class, you can have some more. If you got your Bible with you, let's turn to John's Gospel. I'm sorry, the first letter of John, author of John's Gospel, chapter 3. We're thinking about the point today. The point, 1 John chapter 3. We're going to look at verses 21 through 24 today. If you have your Bible open, you can read with me. I'm reading from the King James. You may have a different version. First Epistle of John the Apostle. This is not to a particular church, but to the entire church of that area in the Near East, Middle East, as we call it today. 1 John chapter 3, verses 21 through 24. We're thinking today about the point. Beloved, if our heart is not condemning us, then have we confidence toward God. And whatsoever we receive, we ask, we receive of him, because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. And this is his commandment, that we should believe on the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another as he gave us commandment. And he that keepeth his commandments dwelleth in him, and he in him. And hereby we know that he abideth in us by the Spirit which he hath given us. It was a long time ago when dinosaurs roamed the earth. And I was a young college student, and I was experiencing my first piece of nervous illness. Has anybody ever had it? Anybody ever had nerve trouble? Liars. Didn't care for it, didn't know what it was, but that's why I remember it. Had never had that experience before. I was in the middle of that thing. Lasted about 3 months until I found a book that showed me what was going on. Then I was out of it within a month or so. And I remember when I was going through that, I would try to distract myself if I could. One night I was laying on the couch in our bed in our house back in Pittsburgh. And I was lying on the couch, and my sister was sitting on the chair watching television. And something seized me, just almost like out of the blue. It just seized me and shook me. And I sat up on the couch, and she looked over at me. I said, I want my life to count. I want my life to mean something. Okay. And then I laid back down again, watching TV. She only saw the outward. She only heard the outward, but I was experiencing the inward. For some reason, something about the show or what I was going through or my age in life or the college I was going to, I don't know what it was, but it was like a concoction that was mixed up in such a way that I was finally brought up short regarding how fleeting this life is. And I thought, I want my life to count. I want to make a difference. And I had not been born again too awfully long at that point, but I thought about all the people that didn't know Jesus in my family, my extended family at that point, people that I worked with on my job, people that I went to school with, my professors. And I thought, gosh, I want to do something that lasts. How many have ever been gripped like that? You know, I want my life to make sense. When I look back on it, I want to know it's mattered. And you might be asking yourself occasionally, wow, new year, same garbage, different dispenser. You know, you may be looking around and thinking, what's the use? What's the point? Same old, you know, and sometimes worse. And it gets to the place sometimes with some of us that we'd almost rather hold on to the junk we have to face right now, lest we get something that's worse. You know, the devil you know much better than the one you haven't met yet. How sad is that? And I got to believe, it's not God's plan for our lives, is it? I don't believe it's his best. It's not what he wants. He didn't want it for me back in 1973. He doesn't want it for me anymore today either, or you. He wants us to live successfully on two different dimensions, and that is the point. Look at it with me. Two dimensions. As you leave this morning to go out in the foyer and fellowship, have some cake and coffee, you'll notice a wooden cross over the exit sign. That was gifted to us by one of our former members, whom I haven't seen in years now. But that is a picture, that is a sign and symbol of the normal Christian life. That is the point. That cross is the point of it all. It's the normal Christian life, our relationship vertically toward God and our relationship horizontally toward other people. It's not two crosses, it's two beams. It's one cross. It's not two kinds of life. It's one life. A life that begins with a gift of life from God above and then shares that gift of divine life and love with people that we rub shoulders with every day. If you look at the scripture with me, John has just made a wonderful promise of answered prayer. How many saw that? Verses 21 and 22. He says, if you and I are true saints, interesting way he wrote it, it's called a condition of the third class, meaning likely but not necessarily. Doesn't that just sound like today's church? He didn't know who he was writing to. He knew the congregations, but he hadn't met every member. So he's saying, if, and it's likely that you lot are all really believers, but some of you may not be, but if we're true saints and our hearts are not condemning us as they did before salvation, you and I and every believer can ask for whatever we desire and will receive it. Why? Why? Since we're keeping his commandments and doing or practicing the things that are pleasing before him. The first, the commandments, we'll look at in a moment. The second refers to daily impressions of the Holy Spirit that come to you, that come to me to be, do, or say at God's bidding. I was thinking, for example, of a friend of the church, not a member, who supports the church regularly. And just recently, he wrote me that there was a bank error. He had authorized a check for a particular amount to be sent to the church, and a little time went by, and he realized it hadn't been debited from his account. So he thought, man, I want this check to go to the church. So he cut another one. A little while later, he found out there was a bank error, looked at his bank account, and both had been debited. Now, what did he do? Well, bless God, he canceled the one. No. No, he said, I just let her go. He said, computer error. He said, no big. He said, so you got two checks coming. I got one the other day, and guess what? I think there'll be one probably Tuesday. Happy Tuesday. Go to the P.O. box. Instead of a bill, you've got a gift. We need it. We used to have a bit of a cushion. It's more like a doily now. So everything that comes in is helpful. But I thought that's the normal Christian life. I think to myself, well, you should let that other check go through after all I've done for you. He's not a member here. He has no connection here. He just likes what we're doing. He believes in a local full gospel church, a place where people operate in the gifts and a place where people are trained up and sent out into ministry. More than that, he believes in a place that has its arms wide open to embrace 180 countries. Well, guess what? A little while after that, he was going over another bill that's an automatic withdrawal from his account, and there was a bank error in his favor. Guess what he got back? The same amount of the second check. He said, I love this stuff, LOL, and a smiley face. And I thought, me too. Let the errors continue. I was on my computer this morning before I came out, and I'm going through the emails, and there you've received a gift, you know, that automatic deal. And I'm looking, I looked twice. One was just a token amount to see if the service was working. The second was not a token amount. And I look just like Missy right now. My eyes were like half dollars, you know. My eyebrows were touching my forehead, you know. Wow, you know. And I thought, well, once again, of course they would gift us after all we've done for him. Not a member, nothing to do with this church, and yet knows about it, God, he understands, is prospering him in some new and wonderful ways lately. And so what did he do? Vertical beam. Every good and perfect gift is constantly coming down from above, from the Father of lights, with whom is no shadow of turning. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. That's the heart of Christ, to be a lover and a giver. Amen? To share with what you've received from above. God blesses you. You bless God's people and God's work. That's the real deal. How many of you know some people are not experiencing the real deal or expressing it? Shouldn't be that way, should it? Yeah, the first thing is that responding, I should say the second part, practicing the things that are pleasing in his sight, they're not listed there. This is not like some local churches. Here's our statement of faith, one page. Here are our doctrinal, here are our commitments. It's like toilet paper. You could just keep unraveling it, you know. You do this, you don't do that. You do this, you don't do, you eat that, you don't eat that. You dress this way, blah, 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 blah. And then you got to do that for about 6 months. Then they'll receive you into their frozen chosen, you know, get your name on the roll. Oh, those churches are fun. Every year you have the yearly board battle. I mean, board meeting. Those are fun. No, it's not that there's a particular list of do's and don'ts. It's different for Bill than it is for me. What God tells me to do, impresses me to do, is different to what he'll tell Greg or the other Greg. We're getting lousy with Gregs. We're lousy with Ricks. We got half a dozen Ricks. They're usually not here, so it doesn't get confusing. And for different reasons, they can't get here. But anyway, this is what it's all about. Now, will you notice the first part I said we'd get back to in just a minute? We do his commandments. We obey his commandments. Commandments, plural. Did you know the Old Testament law, last I remember, had about 613 rules? 613 different rules and regulations in the Torah and the Old Covenant law. Not to mention the additional traditions that the religious elite had added on. No wonder Peter in Acts 15, verse 10, called the law a yoke, a burden neither he nor his forefathers could bear, that some Jewish believers were trying to put on the shoulders of new Gentile, non-Jewish converts. He and the rest of the Jewish believers were staggering under that load of 613 plus, 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 plus. That's not what John is talking about here. You and I can't keep those. In contrast, our Lord pared it all down to just two. So easy to remember. A cross. A cross. The vertical beam, loving God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Jesus in Matthew's gospel told the one that asked him, what is the greater commandment? This, but I say is, this. Yeah, our master used a demonstrative pronoun there. Afti. This is the first, proti, and great commandment. Okay. Love God with my heart, mind, soul, and strength. What about the horizontal? Jesus said to the one asking him. And the second, like it. You shall be loving your neighbor as yourself. Then he comes in for a landing. On these, everybody say these. Plural of the other word. Demonstrative pronoun. It's just like Jesus looked at the 613 laws, plural, of the Old Covenant and all of the myriad of traditional commandments added on by the religious elite of the day. He looks at all of that, wipes it aside, and points, just like he's pointing with his finger, on these, toughness, the two commandments, all the law and the prophets hang. You're probably not much different than me. You've probably had some pictures, photographs, certificates ruined or partially ruined because the nail on which the plaque was connected to the wall came loose and it fell and the glass shattered, etc., etc. Jesus said the whole point of life is these two commandments. Everything you and I want, anything you and I could desire by way of personal fulfillment or to bring glory to God or to bless someone else is in that cross. Making him Lord and then letting his new life work through us and things we do, things we say, sometimes things we feel with other people. You ever been around somebody really going through it and your mind's going like a little hamster on a wheel? Now, which verse is that? What story? Who is that character in the Bible? Got to tell them something. You don't. Often you don't have to say anything. Just let them know you feel for them. And if you've been where they are, you feel with them. I've been at this a little while. In 45 years, I've done a fair bit of counseling. You should see the expression on the person's face change when they talk about their problem. And without going into details, I say something like, yeah, I remember what happened to me and how it changed my life, and just give them the very bare bones of it. The entire countenance changes. He gets it. He sees me. I've been waiting for this all my life, and I haven't given them any advice. Suddenly they realize, I'm not alone. That's the point of life. They leave, and I just sit there sometimes, smile like the cat that ate the canary. Oh, man, it's all worth it. All that mess, it's worth it if it lets someone else know they're not alone. They're not unusual. They're not off-brand. They're not kicked to the side of the road, never to stand again. Someone else has been where they are and has lived to tell about it. This is the point of life. I'm sure you've read this somewhere. It's been in lots of articles. When people are dying, or if they have a near-death experience, they don't think about the car they had or didn't get. They don't think about that vacation home they never invested in. They don't see their stock portfolio and, oh, I had a chance at Tesla and I didn't invest. They don't think about any of that stuff. They see people's faces. They see people. They see relationships. Oh, I wished I should have. Oh, I'm so glad I... That's what life's all. That's the point. That's what I think sees me on that couch in 1973. Man, I want my life to count. I don't want to just mark time, just get by, get through. Same old, same old. No, I want to know my life is real and means something. How about you? And it takes both. It takes both. If we have only the first one, our lives can become self-centered. Just me and Jesus. Hey, that's the start, but it shouldn't end there. If that's all it is, we can become self-centered, narcissistic, spiritually even. Dr. Thomas Wyatt, who founded the Wings of Healing Ministry, Pentecostal ministry of the early 1900s, talked about a formula for failure. Impression minus expression leads to depression. The believer who's constantly taking in. You know them. They've got a Bible with them the size of New York. And you go to their car, the CDs are tumbling out of the glove box, you know, and the DVDs and this and that. You know, they got 76 channels of Christian television. So they paid extra so they could get it all, you know. And they can tell you not only who the Antichrist is, but what kind of toothpaste he'll use and what car he drives. It's not a Tesla, Solomon. Anyway, think about this. That's not what it's about. That's not what it's about. Just taking in. It should also be sharing, giving. Nothing wrong with CDs. Nothing wrong with watching Christian TV. Some of it. Very small, some of it. But what do you do with that knowledge? Share it with somebody else. Oh, look what I read. Look what I found, you know. Share it with someone else. How many have ever been benefited by a book? I have. I've told you 1 or 2 million times. Doing a crusade when I was pastoring in another city. I was called as an evangelist to go to another city about an hour and a half away, Methodist Church. I was there for, it was supposed to be 3 days. It turned into 9 days. And I was graced by the pastor to stay with an elderly woman who had a big house and lots of empty rooms. Once again, he loved God. He wanted a revival. He wanted to glorify God in his Methodist church. And he knew me from other meetings I'd been in Full Gospel Businessmen, et cetera, et cetera. So he invited me over. The meetings were wonderful. This was not something in the Bible. This was not one of 613 laws or a tradition. This was something he was impressed. Called me. I went. Great things happened. He was impressed. He said, I feel like instead of putting you in a hotel, let you stay with Sister So-and-so. I said, that's fine, whatever. And so I stayed there. And about the third night I was there, I heard these footsteps, creaky floor coming down the hall. I was reading my Bible by a little bedside lamp. Boom, boom, boom. She waltzes in with a couple of books in her hand. She says, I know you like to read. I thought you might like to read this guy's books. Do you think that heaven opened and an angel came down? Thou must share the book with the evangelist. She just had an impression. I hear this guy preach. He talks about the books he reads. He likes books. I was burning a midnight oil reading that guy's books. I read every one she gave me. Got the address. I wound up reading about 600 books that he had written. Took 7 of his courses. Learned more from him than I had in 3 years of seminary. And it was one of the top 5 conservative seminaries in this country. Big doors open with little keys, don't they? I'm talking about the point of life. Loving God and loving your neighbor enough to respond to the impressions of the Holy Spirit to do the things that are pleasing in His sight, whatever it might be. Having someone stay at your house, loaning them a book, giving them a book, whatever. If we have only the second, loving our neighbor, then we can wind up with nothing more than humanism. How many of you know church groups that go hither, thither, and yon, building hospitals and schools? Is there anything wrong with any of that? Of course not. Do you have to be a Christian to do that work? No. No. That's not the gospel. That's wonderful, but a humanist, a non-believer, an atheist can go to another country and build a school or a hospital. Anybody can do that. Any human person can do that. But that doesn't bring that person eternal life. That doesn't fill them with the Holy Ghost and fire. That doesn't heal their sickness or deliver them from devils or break their bondage or lift their burden. That doesn't heal them in the inner man like the gospel does. And if we don't have the first and the second, our lives are out of whack. We're either self-centered or we're possibly just humanists doing good with our fallen flesh. So what's the point? Here it is. Christmas time, if Jesus is the reason for the season, I submit to us today that here's the giving of living. Listen to John. And this, afti, demonstrative pronoun. Gosh, John, a lot of different laws, a lot of different traditions, a lot of different practices. Which one are you talking about? This is his commandment in order that we should believe on the name of his son, Jesus Christ, and should be loving one another even as he gave commandment to us. Notice the switch from plural to singular. We keep his commandments, plural, and do the things that are pleasing in his sight. And this is his commandment. 2 beams in that cross, but it's 1 cross. On the surface, 2 commandments, loving God, loving our neighbor, but it's actually 1. It's actually 1. It all comes back to love. In this day and age of grace, it's Christ Jesus who is the object of our faith. To believe on the name of his son, Jesus Christ. In the old covenant, pledging your faith in Yahweh was the way of salvation. In the New Testament, Yahweh has revealed himself in the person of his son, Jesus Christ. To believe in the name of Jesus Christ is to believe in the person of God in the flesh. How many of you know the Old Testament name, even today, for God is Hashem? Our Jewish brethren were so afraid of mispronouncing the ineffable name that they wouldn't use the word Yahweh. They would simply sometimes call him Adonai, which is Lord, or they would say Hashem, the name. How many know John was Jewish? This same John, in another of his letters, commends believers that help Christian missionaries on their way. He says, it's wonderful that you helped them get to where they were going because they went out for the sake of the name, is what he writes. Not Jesus, But everyone knew what he meant because he was Jewish. So he just said in Greek, Hashem, the equivalent in Greek. They went out for the name. That's what he's saying here. Believe on the name of Yahweh's Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another. I want to tell you something else about this. Believe here is believe at a point in time. Pistefsomen, to believe at a point in time. It's aorist, punctiliar. What's that talking about, Pastor? That's talking about when you first really hear the Savior's call, the shepherd's call. You first really hear the gospel and understand it, and you commit yourself, like Abraham committed himself to Yahweh when God said, of your seed, I'll people this world. He committed himself. We commit ourselves. We make Jesus Lord of our lives at a point in time. That's aorist. It happens at a point in time. We're born again from above. How many of you mothers would like to bear children gradually? 5, 10, 30 years, and finally the birth. That's the way a lot of people are about Christianity. You're a Christian? I'm trying to be. How long have you been trying? Oh, about 10, 20 years. Eventually I'll get there. Look, there's a pregnancy that's 9 months, but there's a birth, right? It takes place at a point in time. I know my wife doesn't want a 30-year birth. Wow, I was going to say she screamed like a woman, but she is a woman, you know. That was something. That was quite something. I was just an innocent bystander, you know. It happens at a point in time when we make Jesus Lord. But the verb for loving one another is present tense. That's a lifestyle, amen? Our walking out of the Christian life is a lifestyle. We're loving others with God's love and not ours. It's not humanism. Deliver us, Lord, from carnal churches. I've got a friend, acquaintance, who is the pastor of one of the largest churches in Eurasia, over 30,000 members. I had a couple of phone conversations with him. He was so touched and blessed by Solomon's own website with information there, which led him to our website. He was so blessed and helped by my books and sermons and whatnot. He gave me two very generous gifts over about 5 to 6 years. I never asked him for anything, of course. The first time I talked to him on the telephone, I asked him if we could maybe email once in a while. He said, I don't do email. And he gave me his home address, his home phone number. Person he's never met, never laid eyes on. That's God. That's this. That's the point of life. He told me one book of mine changed his life. Now, what price can you put on that? And then he's pastoring over 30,000 people and he's on all kinds of television shows and whatnot. That's wonderful, isn't it? But that's the real deal. How can you and I tell if we've got the real thing versus the false? I just watched a documentary about a guru from one of these foreign places, you know, and supposedly telling people precepts to live by in health and exercise and this and that. The other side, he was a sexual predator. Yeah, they're still looking for him, trying to bring him to justice. He's in another country living, still doing the same thing he did here. Multi-millionaire, professing one thing, living another. It's everywhere, isn't it? And none of us are immune to missing it once in a while. Did you hear what happened with the Pope recently? God bless him. The Pope, did you see or hear? It's on all the news. It's gone viral. Yeah, it was a New Year's Eve service, prayer service. He had just come out of it. He's walking along, you know, going back to where he was going, shaking hands, you know. You can imagine people, bless me, Father, you know. And you understand that they're part of his church. And you know, and so he was just about done, and he was walking away, and one of the worshipers reached out and grabbed his hand before he left. I've had that happen to me all over the world. If you bless someone, they want to be near you. And it just reminded me, when I saw the video clip on, I was watching the news, it reminded me of the woman with the issue of blood. Hey, before you go, don't forget about me. Just took his hand, and he turned around when he felt his hand grabbed, and she pulled his hand toward her. She was talking to him, trying to tell him something. He slapped her on the hand repeatedly and verbally scolded her. Then he turns from her, and the camera sees his face, quite angry. Well, I mean, all of us make mistakes. Would you agree? But I just thought the way things were handled was a little odd. It was a little odd. He made an apology publicly, and I saw it. And what he said was, all of us get impatient. My impatience got the best of me. I apologize for being a bad example. That was the apology. I just put myself in her place, and I thought, well, I appreciate the apology for giving Christians a bad example, but what about the apology for slapping me repeatedly and verbally scolding me? What about apologizing for that? The very next day in his first service, part of his sermon, he said, "Women are sources of life and deserve respect. Every form of violence inflicted upon them is blasphemy to God." So how can we tell the difference between true and false Christianity? John says the one continually keeping his commandments remains in him, and he in him. This is the believer, the true believer, confessing Jesus as Lord, not a church, not a denomination, not a faith group, a parent church group, but Jesus and Jesus only, our faith in him, plus nothing, minus nothing, and then loving one another with the love he's given us. That's the one that abides in him. But how can you and I be sure that we're not self-deceived? You ever wonder? How can we be sure? Well, I believe I'm practicing the things that he tells me. You know, I did make that phone call. I sent that check. I did do that text. I wrote that letter. But here's another way to assure ourselves that we're the real deal. How do you do that, Pastor? By abiding in some church's rites and rules and rituals and feasts and fasts and festivals? Do we have to be like the members of those two good old Made in the USA cults, go door to door with our little valise full of false doctrine and little books? Is that what we have to do? And tick all the boxes? I made so many stops today. How do we assure ourselves? How many are glad there's something better? Look at your neighbor and say, "There's something better." Here's the second way we know that we're the real deal. And by this, everybody say this. There it is again, demonstrative pronoun. Not by where you go to church, how long you fast, how many hours you pray, how many services you attend, how many rituals you keep. No, that's not how. By this, tuto, we are knowing that he resides in us by the Spirit whom he gave to us. The Spirit of God within us and upon us. One commentary wrote this about this: imperfect obedience to commandments of the Lord or impressions he gives us by his Spirit leads to imperfect assurance of salvation. Sure, we do the best we can, but we're never necessarily always sure we're doing it exactly like he wants. So isn't there some other way? Yes, there is, an experience. To be born of the Spirit, to be baptized in the Spirit, to have the Spirit of God upon us and flowing through us. In Acts chapter 11, verses 16 and 18 through 18, Peter's recounting what happened when he went to the household of Cornelius, preached the gospel that they had already heard about and believed. But when they heard him reiterate what they had already heard, their faith was confirmed. And before he got to his closing illustration, the Holy Ghost fell on all those who heard the word. Their faith was confirmed. The Spirit of God rose up within them and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them the ability, just as the first 120 did on the day of Pentecost. And when Peter told this to the believing Jews, what did they say? Oh, they received the Spirit just like us. So then God has given to the Gentiles also the gift of a change of mind about Jesus, which leads to life. How do we know? We practice lordship of Christ, loving one another, but we don't do that perfectly. Is there another way too? Yes, by the indwelling and anointing of the Spirit of God that flows through us that non-believers do not have. How many are glad about that? I don't know about you, but I got a relationship, not a religion, when I made Jesus Lord. I got a new life. I did not turn over a new leaf when I made Jesus Lord. When I was born again and 2 years later baptized in the Holy Ghost, I don't know about you, but I finally discovered the point. Reestablish my relationship. Be no more a prodigal. Come home to God. Receive his life. Receive his anointing. And spend the rest of my life walking and talking with him on a regular basis. keeping those commandments of making him Lord and loving each other, and then following through on those impressions that come to be, do, or have something related to helping someone else on a daily basis. When you get to where Ron just got, you look back, you live that way, you have the point. It's all good. It's all grand. It's all glorious. Father, thanks so much for the point of living on this whirling globe of confusion where even nature has gone nutter on occasion. Thank you, Lord, for this two-beamed cross that reminds us of the point. Lord, 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 thanks for your call and for giving us the ability to hear, to respond, and to follow you rather than a stranger. Thank you, Lord, as we responded and followed, you then gave us eternal life because we're your sheep, we're your called, chosen, and elect. We're part of that group the Father gave to you from eternity past, that he is expecting you to resurrect when you return. We love you, Lord, and we thank you for counting us in and giving us the grace to RSVP. Help us, Lord, to remember this new year how simple life really is. Thanks in advance for opportunities to sometimes do no more than just be with someone who's going through it, letting them know we sat where they sit. We felt what they feel. We made it, and so will they. Lord God, bless those who are members here, who pray, who attend, who support, who serve. Bless those in the tri-state who stand with us, others in all 50 states in the Union, still others in nearly 180 nations who are glad spiritually because we're here. Let what they expend for the gospel come back like a mighty boomerang and a thousandfold harvest where, when, and how they need it most. We are just so happy to be yours and to have you be ours. Bless us as we come around your table. Lord Jesus, as your risen flesh and blood enter our physical bodies today, thank you for strength in the place of weakness, healing in the place of sickness. Thank you for the medicine of immortality that grants us longevity in the place of premature demise. In Jesus' name, we give you praise, Father. Amen and amen.
So happy to be a Christian today. There may be another religion someplace that does what Christianity does, but I've yet to see it. We're giving today, that's great. The baskets are here and also one in the foyer. Wrap your seeds with faith. Hallelujah.
The sun that rises every day. Oh, you are so faithful, dear. every breath that I breathe, you are so faithful, Lord. Like a rose that comes alive every spring, oh, you are so faithful, dear Lord, you are faithful. Like the life that you give to every beat of my heart, you are so faithful, Lord. I see a cross and the price you had to pay. I see the blood that washed my sins away.
This is the moment. If the Lord can join himself to a prayer cloth or flow through a human hand, anoint someone's clothing to be a carrier of his presence, how much more can he join himself to the bread and fruit of the vine of the Lord's Supper? If you're just close your eyes and think about Jesus, be cognizant of what you're holding in your hands in just a moment. The miracle of sacramental union. Are you weak? What were you praying about this last week? E-A-K. What was weak this last week? This is the time to find strength for it. What are you sick with or were you sick with? This is the time and the place to find healing. Did the devil scare you with a night dream? Nightmare, premature demise, take your life from you? Did he scare you about an auto accident or some new strain of flu? Did you watch television and say, what about our area? Could there be a tornado or something here would wreck my house? What is he tormenting you with? This is the time to believe God for longevity, the renewal of youth, the Abraham, Caleb, miracle of rejuvenation. Now's the time. Our faith always needs a focus. Let it be the God who will be in your hand in just a moment. Thank you, Lord Jesus. for visiting us regularly, not only through your Holy Spirit, but personally through your risen flesh and blood in this wonderful supper you gave us in the place of the Old Testament Passover. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, Lavete, faiete, tuto est in to sumamo, tu iperimon, clomenon, cede dominon. Take, eat, this is my body, which is being broken and given for you. Do this as often as you eat it in the remembrance of me. I hear the words healing glory. Healing glory. It's going to be the lack of which we haven't seen since the days of the early church. Healing glory. Healing glory. Some offices in the body of Christ are going to start emerging from the preceding darkness. It will be as though the spotlight of heaven will come upon them. And these men and women of God will be doing unusual exploits in the Spirit. And it will be like Bible days are finally here again. As we're gathered here this morning, I want to remind us to please be as obedient as we can to those subtle impressions. We know how much it means when we get that email, when we get the letter, when someone gives us that check, when someone shares a word from God that we've been needing. Let's be wise and let's be available to do that for someone else. A year and a half ago, Bill came for prayer. He was fixing to have a procedure done, and as I looked at him, I said, I see something silver right in your middle here. We prayed, took a stress test a little while later, and they canceled a procedure that was supposed to take place. A year and a half later, it was time to have a procedure done. And before he went, I told him I had an impression. I'd seen myself just embracing him, hugging him, not praying, just hugging him. So again, I did what I saw, and he received it, just embraced him. While he was there, they had the procedure. It went perfect, but there was a little blip, a little complication. And they were trying to find out exactly what the story was, and they wanted yet another test, but they weren't sure they could do it because what they had done was place something silver right in here, silver colored. And it's in there. Why would God reveal that a year and a half in advance to someone who's not that kind of doctor? So that we would know it's all good when it happens. It's all good. Praise God. No. No, silver here? What's that about? Why not gold? Isn't that good enough for gold? And you've heard, probably tired of hearing it, but Andy, same thing. Wednesday night class. I'm just telling what I see. I'm just encouraging you when you feel it, when you're impressed. Step out, one-on-one, whatever it is. Saying different things I saw, and I see the Lord pointing at someone's chest, and I said what I thought he was saying. I'm going to give that baby a reset. At the same time, Andy's in Christ Hospital being diagnosed. When the procedure was done, the doctor said, well, you might say this was like a reset. When I told Andy that in the hospital room, I saw his eyes, you know. I told him what happened before he told me what the doctor said. He was just kind of nodding. I love that stuff. Our God is real. He is real. This isn't a religion. It's a relationship. We're not perfect. We're getting there. But thank God it's not about our perfection. It's about the gift of God. It's awesome. Oh, wait a minute. We're still in the Lord's Supper, aren't we? Praise God. I don't know, but I put my pants on one leg at a time, just like you lot. Please, don't get the wrong impression. I had some terrible times this week. Man, terrible times. But that doesn't disqualify us from helping somebody else or from getting over it or getting through it. Amen? Hallelujah. You'd be surprised what you can recover from. In the same way, he also took the cup after the supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Piete ex eftu pandes, tuto carestin to imamo, totis kinis theathiki, to peripolon ekinominon esaphisin amartion. All of you drink out of it. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, the one that's being poured out for the many for the remission of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in the remembrance of me. Precious in the sight of Yahweh, the death of his saints. Thanks, Lord, for sending your angels to carry Ron into your intimate presence. Thank you for his reunion with family members, friends, church members, workmates, those who were in service with him, those who drove the trucks with him. Thanks, Lord, that he finished the course, he ran his race, fought the fight, and kept the faith. He's at rest in your presence, and his works do follow him. Thank you, Lord, for the happy anticipation of seeing him again at your return. Yahweh, may he bless you and protect you. Yahweh, may he make his face shine on you and be gracious and merciful to you. Yahweh, may he lift up his countenance upon you and grant you his shalom. Amen. Praise the Lord Jesus. Coffee and cake out there. If you need prayer, we're always here to join our faith with yours. If you want to just spend some time praying, that's great.